Our speaker this morning is Dr. Anne Klaeysen, one of our three leaders at the Society. In addition to her work at the Society, and she does so much for us, Dr. Anne Klaeysen is the humanist religious life advisor at Columbia University and Barnard College. A graduate of the Humanist Institute, she is now co-dean of the Institute. She holds a Doctor of Ministry degree from Hebrew Union College. Is it two masters? Two masters in business administration from NYU, one master and another one from the State University of New York at Albany. This month, being National Poetry Month, Anne's talk is entitled Ethics and Poetry. It is truly my pleasure to welcome Dr. Anne Klaeysen.
Poetry. Why bother? Some people say, you know, you either hate it or you love it. There's nothing in between. I'm one of those who loves poetry, and I hope that many of you do as well. And if you don't, perhaps you will by the end of the morning. The reason I call this Ethics and Poetry is that I think that poetry really can help us to be better people. But before we get into that part of my talk, let's just ask, what is poetry? And for that, I'm going to read a poem by Elizabeth Alexander called Ars Poetica number 100, I believe. Poetry, I tell my students, is idiosyncratic. Poetry is where we are ourselves, digging in the clam flats for the shell that snaps, emptying the proverbial pocketbook. Poetry is what you find in the dirt in the corner, over here on the bus, God in the details, the only way to get from here to there. Poetry, and now my voice is rising, is not all love, love, love. And I'm sorry the dog died. Poetry, here I hear myself loudest, is the human voice. And are we not of interest to each other? So I think that says a lot. Are we not of interest to each other? And that interest, that concern, that care, so often is expressed in poetry. Now, how does one sit down and write a poem? How many have written poems throughout their lives? Kind of a way of expressing something that's dear, that you notice, something that you just feel an impulse to write about. And we often do that in private, but this poem by Jay Lemming, called Man Writes Poem, makes it seem as though he's being observed. Man writes poem. This just in, a man has begun writing a poem in a small room in Brooklyn. His curtains are apparently blowing in the breeze. We go now to our man Harry on the scene. What's the story down there, Harry? Well, Chuck has begun the second stanza and seems to be doing fine. He's using a blue pen. Most poets these days use blue or black ink, so blue is a fine choice. His curtains are indeed blowing in a breeze of some kind, and what's more, his radiator is whistling somewhat. No metaphors have been written yet, but I'm sure he's rummaging around down there in the tin cans of his soul and will turn up something for us soon. Hang on, just breaking news here, Chuck. There are, quote, birds singing, close quote, outside his window, and a car with a bad muffler has just gone by. Yes, definitely, a confirmation on the singing birds. Excuse me, Harry, but the poem seems to be taking a very auditory quality at this point, wouldn't you say? Yes, Chuck, you're right. But after years of experience, I would hesitate to predict exactly where this poem is going to go. Why, I remember being on the scene with Frost in 47 and Stevens in 53. And if there's one thing about poems these days, it's that, hang on, there's something happening here. He's just compared the curtains to his mother. And he's described the radiator as, quote, roaring deep with the red walrus of history, close quote. Now that's a key line, especially appearing here somewhat late in the poem when all of the similes are about to go home. In fact, he seems a bit knocked out with the effort of writing that line, and who wouldn't be? Looks like, yes, he's put his pen down and is going to brush his teeth. Back to you, Chuck. Well, thanks, Harry. Wow, the life of the artist. That's it for now, but we'll keep you informed of more details as they arise. So it can be very mundane, can't it? It can be, all sorts of things go on with poetry. And now I'm going to take a break at this time. You have all reached into the bags, you pulled out some poems. I hope you've had an opportunity to look at them. Does any one of you have a poem about poetry itself or about the act of writing a poem? I know there were some in the bags, maybe they can pull it up. Any person have a poem about poetry itself or the act of writing a poem or anything close to it? But does anyone have a poem that they particularly liked when they opened it up and would love to read it right now? Okay, go Jamie. And do we have a wireless mic? I think we don't. How about coming up here? Do you want to make sure we get it on our tape, or do you want to make sure everyone hears it?
Sorry, I haven't had time to rehearse it, though. It's called The Weight by Linda Gregg, and it's from her book, Chosen by the Lion, Grey Wolf Press, 1994. Two horses were put together in the same paddock, night and day, in the night and in the day, wet from heat and the chill of the wind on it, muzzle to water, snorting, head swinging, and the taste of hay in the shadowed air. The dignity of being. They slept that way, knowing each other always. Withers quivering for a moment, fetlock and the proud rise at the base of the tail, width of back. The volume of them and each other's weight. Fences were nothing compared to that. People were nothing. They slept standing, their throats curved against the other's rump. They breathed against each other, whinnied and stomped. There are things they did that I do not know. The privacy of them had a river in it, had our universe in it. And the way its border looks back at us with its light. This was finally their freedom, the freedom an oak tree knows that is built at night by stars.
Thank you. You read that so beautifully. It sounded like you're really savoring each syllable. Thank you. So, again, why poetry? Really? Why should we care about it? Isn't it rather obscure? Well, there was an article recently in the New York Times that I really appreciated. It was actually a book review by David Kirby, and it was written about a book called Beautiful and Pointless, which was written by David Orr, who is both a poet and a lawyer. Kind of an interesting combination, although, as many of us know, if you are a poet, you need to have a day job. Little family aside. My son, who majored in religion at the University of Rochester, decided afterwards that he would get a master's in fine arts in poetry, to which my husband Glenn said that you, my son, need a civil service job. And of course, I talked about Wallace Stevens being an insurance agent and a So fortunately, he did. He works in the Parks Department right across Central Park at the Arsenal, and he's the coordinator of the Million Trees NYC program. He does still write poetry. And one day maybe he will get that master's degree. But it points out that, you know, why do this when you really don't make money? The poet laureate doesn't make any money. I mean, it makes something. And then, of course, is called upon to write poems on demand. But those of us who enjoy poetry, love it, and love writing it, we know we have to have some other job. So, why? Well, David Orr has this new guide to modern poetry, and he really wants to help folks sort of understand it better, but not as a kind of a code or a mystery. I mean, if it's a code or a mystery and you have to unravel it, why would you bother? I mean, you really want something that could speak to you. So he talks about the ways in which poetry can speak to us at different times of our lives, not only as individuals, but as a nation. And he refers to September 11th. And he said, even today, almost 10 years later, the poems that are most evocative of that time for us was in W.H. Auden's September 1st, 1939, and also the recent poet laureate Kate Ryan's Home to Roost. But even that poem had been written before. So it's interesting. Sometimes, you know, you are called upon it, and sometimes it comes to you, and sometimes you have to really delve into the archives and the treasures of poetry to express the things that you have in your heart. Interesting for this crowd, perhaps, is that David Orr also says that almost all poets, including myself, lean left. There are maybe five conservative American poets. Not one of them can safely show his face at a writing conference for fear of being angrily doused with herbal tea. Now, he quotes another poet laureate, Rita Dove, who says that poetry is language at its most distilled and most powerful. But he argues that really the Nike slogan, "Just Do It," is probably more distilled than anything the poet James Merrill ever wrote, and that Martin Luther King's letter from the Birmingham jail beats William Carlos Williams for sheer power every time. He said what it does do is express our innermost selves. And as I said before, some people hate it or love it. Very few people are in between, are neutral. And so he decided that he was going to test that out. And what he did was he went on Google, where else do we go these days, and he conducted two different searches, I like X, I love X. And he wanted to find out, you know, those things that people like and love. And X being something like baseball, gardening, poetry. And what he found out was, and he said the science behind this, of course, is ridiculous. I mean, he just decided to go on. But he said, in every instance except two, more people like an activity than love it. For example, readers of romance novels like that art 3 to 36 times more than they love it. The exceptions are poker, which splits 50-50, and of course, poetry, whose partisans love it twice as much as they like it. So, what do we do with that? One of the things I try to think in sense of that innermost self, is that he talks about the final days of his father, who had had a stroke and suffered from cancer. And the therapist recommended some exercises. But Orr had another idea. He said, why not poetry? Why not use an art form with obvious stresses and rhymes, especially one people love so much? So he said the first thing you want to make sure was to stay clear of Gerard Manley Hopkins. The lines are too crowded, they're too difficult to read, and he figured that Robert Frost wasn't much better. In the end, he decided that he would read The Owl and the Pussycat, Edward Lear's classic tribute to interspecies romance. And his father loved it. I mean, loved it. At the end, his father tells him, just before he dies, I really like the Runcible Spoon. And that's close enough to love for me. So, I think that poetry can make us better people. And I think it can do that in three ways, actually four. One, it opens up time and space for us to give us an opportunity to reflect upon our own lives and other lives, the very meaning of life. The second one is that sometimes poetry can give you very good advice, sometimes practical advice. Thirdly, it really helps us to empathize with other people in situations radically different from our own. And empathy, after all, is the basis for ethics. And then finally, I'll throw in a fourth one, just for fun. Sometimes poetry is just plain good fun. So let's go back to the first one, and I'm going to give you examples. Opening up time and space for reflection on what gives life meaning. And this is a poem by Kay Ryan called The Fabric of Life. It is very stretchy, we know that, even if many details remain sketchy. It is complexly woven. That much, too, has pretty well been proven. We are loath to continue our lessons which consist of slaps as sharp and dispersed as bee stings from a smashed nest when any strand snaps. Hurts working far past the locus of rupture, attacking threads far beyond anything we would have said, connects. Then from Ellen Bass, and this one is called, The Thing Is. To love life. To love it even when you have no stomach for it. And everything you've held dear crumbles like burnt paper in your hands, your throat filled with the silt of it. When grief sits with you, its tropical heat thickening the air, heavy as water, more fit for gills than lungs. When grief weights you like your own flesh, only more of it, an obesity of grief, you think, how can a body withstand this? Then you hold life like a face between your palms, a plain face, no charming smile, no violet eyes, and you say, yes, I will take you. I will love you again. And Carol was speaking about Anne Garland Spencer and the notion of desire. So Linda Paston has a poem called, What We Want. What we want is never simple. We move among things we thought we wanted, a face, a room, an open book, and these things bear our names. Now they want us. But what we want appears in dreams, wearing disguises. We fall past, holding out our arms, and in the morning, our arms ache. We don't remember the dream, but the dream remembers us. It is there all day, as an animal is there under the table, as the stars are there, even in full sun. And now I want to take a break and ask if any of you are holding on to poems that have a reflective quality to them, a reflective tone.
At least it was reflective to me. This one is called Hospital Days by Soylent Thompson. The tests, the blood work, they were good days with magazines absorbed the time spent waiting. The nurses' banter spread a sheen of normalcy over everything. And the doctors left a little space and their advice were stirred by large. Lodge. The three of us went everywhere together, and at last I knew the pleasure that the only child takes in company of our makers. Then the doctor came to us one day and said the chemo hadn't made the kind of progress he was looking for, that we could take my mother home and stay. We sat there, stunned by what our weeks of rushing through appointments had not left us to contemplate, and then drove home without speaking. This day, unlike the others, would not end with smiles and goodbyes. My father's and my arms tucked beneath my mother's, and hope's modest, steady flame still unextinguished in us at the thought of being eating supper at the kitchen table before we call the cats in from the bar.
Wow, thank you so much.
That's why I picked the name.
Another thing that poetry can do for us to make us better people is it can give us advice. The National Review of Books this month put a poem in each time in honor of National Poetry Month, and they went into their archives and they found some poetry from the past. And they found a wonderful one by Kenneth Cook, and it's called Some General Instructions. Now, this poem is 233 lines long. I am not going to read all of them, although there is much to be said for reading all of them and getting the flow of it. So I do highly recommend this to you. And you can find it, just Google under poetry, Some General Instructions. The first two lines of this are, do not bake bread in an oven that is not made of stone, or you risk having imperfect bread. That gives you sort of the tone. So he's going to intermix different things in here. He's going to mix up some things like that. But what I did is I cherry picked. And I pulled out some things that I thought would resonate with this crowd. If you feel a law is unjust, you may work to change it. It is not true, as many people say, that that is just the way things are. Or those are the rules immutably. The rules can be changed, although it may be a slow process. Here's another one. The days of allegory are over. The days of irony are here. Irony and deception. But do not harden your heart. Remain kind and flexible. Another one. The problem of being good and also doing what one wishes is not as difficult as it seems. It is, however, best to get embarked early on one's dearest desires. Be attentive to your dreams. They are usually about sex, but they deal with other things as well in an indirect fashion and contain information that you should have. You should also read poetry. And then the last grouping of his stuff from his poem. Do not be defeated by the feeling that there is too much for you to know. That is a myth of the oppressor. You are capable of understanding life, and it is yours alone and only this time. Whatever you experience is both a person out there and a dream, as well as unwashed electrons. It is your task to see through this to a conclusion that makes sense to all concerned, and that reflects credit on this poem, your species, and yourself. Now go. You cannot come back until these lessons are learned, and you can show that you have learned them for yourself. So I do recommend the poem because there are so many delicious things in there. And again, I just selected some things for you this morning. The next poem is a very practical one, and a very lovely one, and it's called How to Become a Stepmother. And I think in this day and age, with so many blended families, and divorce is something like 50%, and I think that many people find themselves in that situation. And I found this incredibly, I was going to say helpful, not for me perhaps, in my current personal situation. However, I think as a pastoral counselor, if I were to have someone come to me with this, I would definitely prescribe this poem. Remember, this is the test you cannot pass. The 13-year-old asks, where are your kids? When you say you don't have any, she tells you, his last girlfriend did, and we are best friends. Feel yourself slip through the blue of her eyes. The 16-year-old watches you from all five corners of the room. When her father is there, she is pleasant, smiles, asks about your cat. When he leaves, a happy man, she tries to kill you seven different ways. She sets herself on fire and says, you did it. She watches your chest rise and fall and hates your breath. If you try to touch her, her arm falls off. She's a sensitive creature. be patient. Soon you marry the father. The girls come late to the wedding and pull wrinkled dresses from paper bags to stand in the living room, crying for their mother. They throw all their arms around their father and hold him tight within their skirts for the last time. Stand outside yourself in your silly white suit with gold buttons. Feel the orchid breathe against your cheek. Finally, the one who hates you most reaches out and pulls you in. Feel all those arms around you. Think, this is my way. This is our way. And then finally, in this particular category of advice is from Louise Adrick. I think some of us have heard this one before. And if you are a domestic type of person, or you are then forced into being a domestic, play that domestic role in your home, I think you will appreciate this. It's called Advice to Myself. Leave the dishes. Let the celery rot in the bottom drawer of the refrigerator and an earthen scum harden on the kitchen floor. Leave the black crumbs in the bottom of the toaster. Throw the cracked bowl out and don't patch the cup. Don't patch anything. Don't mend. Buy safety pins. Don't even sew on a button. Let the wind have its way. Then the earth that invades us as dust, and then the dead foaming up in gray rolls underneath the couch. Talk to them. Tell them they are welcome. Don't keep all the pieces of the puzzle or the doll's tiny shoes in pairs. Don't worry who uses whose toothbrush or if anything matches at all. Accept one word to another or a thought. Pursue the authentic. Decide first what is authentic. Then go after it with all your heart. Your heart. That place you don't even think of cleaning out. That closet stuffed with savage mementos. Don't sort the paper clips from screws from saved baby teeth or worry if we're all eating cereal for dinner again. Don't answer the telephone ever or weep over anything at all that breaks. Pink molds will grow within those sealed cartons in the refrigerator. Accept new forms of life. And talk to the dead who drift in through the screened windows, who collect patiently on the tops of food jars and books. Recycle the mail. Don't read it. Don't read anything except what destroys the insulation between yourself and your experience, or what pulls down, or what strikes at, or what shatters this ruse you call necessity. That's one to put on your refrigerator. Another break. Are any of you holding on to a poem that, come on, that gives us some advice? And please introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Roger Shepherd. This poem definitely gives advice, but I'm not sure it's the best time. It's called Bridal Shower by George Bilguer. Perhaps in a distant cafe, four or five people are talking with the four or five people who are chatting on their cell phones this morning in my favorite cafe. And perhaps someone there, someone like me, is watching them as they frown or smile or shrug at their invisible friends or lovers, jabbing the air for emphasis. And like me, he misses the old days when talking to yourself meant you were crazy. Back when being crazy was a big deal, not just an acronym or something you could take a pill for. I liked it when people were talking to themselves when actually they'd been talking to God or an angel. You respected people like that. You didn't want to kill them, as I want to kill the woman at the next table with the little bright you lightning ear, who has been telling the emptiness in front of her about her daughter's bridal shower in astonishing detail for the past 20 minutes. Oh, person like me, phoneless in your distant cafe, I wish you could meet to discuss this, and perhaps you would help me murder the woman on the side. After which we could have a cup of coffee, maybe a bagel, and talk to each other face to face.
Another way that poetry can help us become better people is helping us to experience empathy. What is it to be another person? Jane Kenyon, Coates. I saw him leaving the hospital with a woman's coat over his arm. Clearly, she would not need it. The sunglasses he wore could not conceal his wet face, his bafflement. As if in mockery, the day was fair, and the air mild for December. All the same, he had zipped his own coat and tied the hood under his chin, preparing for irremediable cold. And you notice how you know to have to hit someone over the head with this, you know, the subtlety of seeing someone and knowing that you're getting in touch with your own and someone else's mortality. The next is by Beverly Wolwagen, and it's called Essential. She just wants to keep her essential sorrow. I'm sorry, let's start again. She just wants to keep her essential sorrow. Everyone wants her to be happy all the time, but she doesn't want that for them. There is value in the thread of sadness in each person. The sobbing child on an airplane, the unhappy woman waiting by the phone, a man staring out the window past his wife. A violin plays through all of them, one long note held at the beginning and the end. And then finally in this category, because I do come from a small town, and can really understand this particular poem. It's by Philip Booth, and it's called Small Town. You know, the light on upstairs before 4 every morning, the man asleep every night before 8, what programs they watch, who traded cars, what keeps the town moving. The town knows, you know. You've known for years over drugstore, coffee, who hurts, who loves. Why today in the house 2 down from the church, people know you cannot stop weeping. So I'm going to take a break here because I think most poems do speak about empathy, and see if there may be a couple of you. Ah, come on up here. This is entitled, At My Brother's Place, by Michelle Boisseau. The TV set, whose picture works, rides on top of the TV whose sound does. The stations change with the needle-nose pliers. From the bed, where he lies most of the day, draggle sheets left with holes where his ashes had dropped. Every surface is covered with the fuzz of ash, punctuated by the twisted cigarette packs. His teeth hurt him to wear. From a chair seat, they grin at a crowd of Coke cans. Here's the Bible he chants from at night, his 3rd this month. They have a way of disappearing, like the $50 bill I gave him yesterday. I brought him salami and cherries, pumpernickel and mustard, a plastic knife to spread it with. And look, new t-shirts, new socks, a roll of stamps and paper, a phone card, an address book where I've written all our numbers. When I've unloaded the packages and he has eaten everything at once, breathing hard, spitting cherry pits into his fist, I walk out to my rental car, clean and empty. Does anyone else have a poem that speaks of empathy? Oh, come on up. They don't really rhyme so much anymore, do they? I wonder if that makes it more difficult to memorize them. The final category is just for fun. And this one I thought was very funny. My husband, however, did not. It is called Hymn to the Comb-Over. And it's by Wesley McNair. How the thickest of them erupt just above the ear, cresting in waves so stiff no wind can move them. Let us praise them in all their varieties, some skinny as the bands of headphones, some rising from a part that extends halfway around the head, other four or five strings stretched so taut the scalp resembles a musical instrument. Let us praise the sprays that hold them, and the combs that coax such abundance to the front of the head in the mirror. The combers entirely forget the back. And let us celebrate the combers, who would dress the old sorrow of times passing day after day, bringing out the barrenness of midlife, this ridiculous and wonderful harvest, no wishful flag of hope, but thick or thin, the flag itself, unfurled for us all in subways, offices, and malls across America. And so I'm going to break now to see if any of you have funny poems or something that tickled your funny bone. Anyone? Come on up.
Nancy, I just want to say I'm so pleased they're here. Nancy and Roger are one of my wedding poems. Oh. And I am cold, so I apologize. But this is close to my heart. It's the Ode to the Potato by Barbara Hanley.
Yeah, Ode to the Potato. They eat a lot of French fries here, my mother announced after a week in Paris, and she's right. Not only about les pommes frites, but the celestial tuber in all its forms, roti puree, not to mention au gratin, or boiled and oiled in la salade niçoise, batala edule, discovered by the gold mad conquistadors in the West Indies, and only 100 years later, the Merry Wives of Windsor Falstaff cries, let the sky rain potatoes, for what would we be without you, lost in a sea of fried turnips, mashed beets, roasted parsnips. Mi corps en mon corps. My core is not the heart, but the stomach tuber of the body. Its hollow stem, the throat, and esophagus leafing out the nose and the eyes and the mouth. Hail the conquering spud, all its names marvelous. Solanum, Tubusum, Ignami, Harry, Russian banana, Yukon gold. When you turn black, Ireland mourned. Oh, Mr. Potato Head, how many deals can a man make before he stops being at small potatoes? How many men can a woman drop like a hot potato? Eat it cooked or raw like an apple with the salt of the earth, apple of the earth, pomme de terre. Tuber, tuber, burning bright, in a kingdom without light, deep within the earth, where the Incan potato god rules, forging their golden orbs for the world's ravaging gorge.
So in conclusion, everyone, poetry can and will make you a better person if you will only allow it to do so. It will open up time and space for you to reflect. It will offer you advice when you need it. It will help you in the process of feeling empathy, even for those that you may hate. And finally, it's just a lot of fun. So, here is my conclusion, put as succinctly as I can put it. Take home a handful of poems. Put them in different rooms of your home. Stuff them in your purses and briefcases. Tuck them in your pockets. Hide them in your cupboards and drawers. Forget about them. Then, one day, when you least expect it, find one. Read it out loud. Let the words roll around in your mouth and savor them. Carry the poem around with you all day. Share it with a friend. Fall asleep and dream about it. Wake up and live better than you ever imagined possible. And that's my advice to you. And now I see that our guest has arrived, so I actually have a poem for you, Ishmael. I'm going to call you up here, but I have a poem that I'm going to give you. I need to read it in a little larger print than that. This is called, it's written by Alex Caldero. It's called Poetry Is Wanted Here. And I'm going to try to get the rhythm because I know that Ishmael is a performance poet, and many of you heard him in January, combines music, rhythm, words, body, everything goes into what he does. So I'm going to come as close to it as an almost 60-year-old woman can. So here we go. Poetry is wanted here. You don't sound so good. Please, take care. Most of this is mental. That's why it's terrorism. It's meant to disconcert, make you revert to blind fear. Poetry is wanted here. And to boot, our homegrown nuts are starting to take root. Yet in most parts, things are calm and generally subdued. But there have been hoaxes, and folks is getting anxious and ready to conclude that it's hopeless and drear. Poetry would be helpful here. So, I'm gonna poetize to realize that you cannot hide when worlds collide. No going inside, no taking a breather either. It all comes in on you at once, and you gotta have at least 1 ounce of hope and joy to deploy into the atmosphere of fear, to implode the load of grief that's drawing near. Poetry is desired here. 'Cause all peoples are just like you are and I are, close or far, are just people with nowhere to run. Let's stick a flower into every gun, like way back when, or was that a dream? Can't say now, feeling so low, seeing so bleak, thinking so drear. Songs are needed here, rhyming and timing, a rebirth of cheer. Poetry would be good here. Bam! We are human after all. America vulnerable yet venerable and human after all. That's our true strength and the real meaning of this happenstance, that we can all fall and scroll and rise and be surprised and not take for granted the morning sun so beautiful and dear. Poetry is wanted here. Forgive me for ranting, for panting, for chanting out of tune. That's the fool in me seeking a tomb in me, wanting to stay light and free from what would oppress, depress, regress, obsess, and in general make a mess of my soul. I want to be whole, in control, on a roll, without the slightest hint of fear. Poetry is needed here. So, my dear friend, hang in, hang on, hang tight. We got to see this to the end. We got to be concerned and discern the real enemy that we fight, for the veil between truth and lie has become so thin and sheer. Poetry is wanted here.
That's that poem. And now Ishmael, who joined us for Martin Luther King Remembrance, is here to perform some of his poetry.
Good morning, everyone. First, I just want to apologize for my lateness today. I had a whirlwind of readings this weekend. So like from Friday to yesterday, I was like doing a bunch of readings. Like Friday, I was in the Poconos. Yesterday, I had a show. So last night, I actually had a chance to sit down and like catch some sleep. And so I woke up and I was like, oh my God, I have to come here. So I really apologize. But I'm glad to be back here. Glad to be welcome back here. And so my name is Ishmael Islam, for those who don't know. And I'm a poet slash filmmaker slash graphic artist slash, I guess, musician. And but today, I have poems for you. And so yeah. So I want to begin. I learned this weekend that whenever you're the poet going somewhere doing readings, you should always read someone else's poetry just to pay homage and respects. So I have two poems I'd like to read from one of my mentors. His name is John Sands, if you've never heard of him. He just released a new book called The New Clean, and it's available through Right Bloody Publishing, and it's available for purchase at rightbloody.com or his website, which I believe is johnsins.com. So he's one of my mentors. I really look up to this man. He's taught me a lot, and a lot of my style comes from his kind of poems. So if I can find the right one. This one is called All I Know. What I Know. Don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. Grandmaster Flash. Feels like dawn, but it's 3:45 on my watch. Priority was to have an extra fly watch. Nobody's got more hours than yesterday's got. See, my body became less alive on my watch. My granddad paid rent. First day each month in this house. Came home from Europe, said, those men died on my watch. Red news, coffee black. Silent zip like a raincoat. My dad next to his brother never tried to cry. Watch. Held my brother tight when I left Boston last month. Said, I love you, dude, but kept an eye on my watch. Said, I understand no one makes it out alive. I swore on lost time, but I lied on my watch. I drank my loving cup. I don't return phone calls, but make certain my shoes match my tie and my watch. Throw game as if I'm the one kid not getting old. Think my ankles won't break when they ride the sky. Watch, this unnamed siren song. Bullet I can't dance through. Bullet I cannot dance through. Bags I'll drop under my eyes if they're tied to my watch. It comes naked as your own skin. Just love. Just love. You just have the people you loved when you die. Watch. That mentorship, he taught me last week that that poem was a hustle, and hustles are when you kind of take one word and you have to repeat it through each stanza. So the repeated word was watch. This next piece I will read from him, which I kind of feel I shouldn't because it's really personal, but and I think only he'd be able to do it, but this is like one of my favorite poems ever. It's kind of, basically it's about marriage, right? And it was a poem for his brother and his now sister-in-law who got married last year. And you know, as a poet, you're like the golden child around wedding time if you're, like, you're available, because they'll actually write a poem and they'll say, just go write the greatest poem about love ever. And so it's like, well, how do you do that, you know, if he's like a 26-year-old, still single, and has commitment issues? Or like, or like if, you know, like I'm a 19-year-old hopeless romantic who just like, you hear a poem like this, you immediately think about your wedding day. So this is why I love this poem so much. So it's called For Molly and My Brother Jacob. Years after my grandmother Grace had left us, my grandfather remained, carrying Alzheimer's in one of his many suitcases. In the hours when dream and reality were not cooperating, those nearest to caregiving would say, Grandpa, Grandpa, what's the best thing you ever did? He would pause, his body now with more contorted exclamation point, and reply, marrying Grace. Or, when the disease would not allow him her absence, the gentle in his eyes would find that of the requester, now playing the role of beautiful woman to whom he had been joined for 56 years, 12 children, one world war, he would reply, marrying you. Love will shave less important details like facts or presents. It will be young. It will lay you flat on the grass, staring up at a jet black out there. Into merengue dance floors where fingers swallow hips. Your head nearly skims the floor when he dips you, and your legs dance together so positive you have to call it love or religion. It will place you on sidewalks that lead toward a way. A wake of regret smudged across the surrounding pavement. Your mouth will say, I'm sorry. Your hands, I was wrong. Eyes, I love you after everything. Your eyes will mean laugh, and laugh will mean forgive. It will find you at 2 a.m. in Wisconsin, when neither of you live in Wisconsin, kneeling beside a couch. She's almost asleep now. There's a plastic gold ring in your palm. You're whispering, I want to spend the rest of my life with you. Sometimes, the couch becomes Nebraska. The floor becomes Houston. The ring is not plastic or even tangible. It is just the distance of a protracted line waiting to be rolled into a circle, but it still is. Love still is a roller coaster. The giant wooden roller coaster at King's Island, even though you don't ride roller coasters, but she loves them and she laughs, which makes you laugh every time. Stories and the characters and the details will smooth through your fingers like a child in a sandbox somewhere. Grandchildren will find you. They will ask you what sits at the top of the right decisions you plucked from all the wrong ones. A trace of gentle in their eyes, and you will reply, marrying Molly, marrying Jacob, or depending on the day, marrying you. The book is The New Clean, it's available now. So now to find the actual work, I have a couple pieces which, ironically, well, coincidentally, both pieces are from a project I just completed and released Thursday. It's basically just audio poems on this here. I have copies with me, they're available, just $5 if anyone enjoys and would like to hear more of these poems. It's actually eight poems on there. So, but this poem in particular is called Braised. I'm part of Urban Word NYC, which is a youth organization, nonprofit, run by the youth. Of course, we have an executive board with older people, but it's basically run by us. We facilitate free after-school workshops, poetry slams, outreach activities where we go to schools and such, just to promote youth literacy and activism. So, and every year they create a team that goes to the National Slam Competition. Last year it was in Los Angeles and we won first place and brought in the championship back home to New York because the Knicks won't. So, So one of my teammates, her name is Jessica Flynn, and the beautiful thing about poetry is that, you know, it resonates to all the poets. Like, and we all get inspired by each other, and that's just a beautiful thing, especially as artists. And, you know, nowadays it's really competitive. The art world is extremely competitive. So, you know, these are just other forms of collaborations. She wrote a poem called Praise, which she didn't enjoy. And it's a beautiful poem, though. And basically throughout the poem, the whole, can't find the right poetic term here, the technical term, but basically the repetition is just of the word praise. So it's basically like just creating a prayer. And all the members from our team did one on their own because she was like, I don't want it anymore, so do what you want. So this is my version of Praise. Praise the light. Praise the light and the signal for the shutters of your eyes to open. Praise the sunrise and the hope it can warm your spine with. Praise the forests and the secrets they urge you to discover. Praise the mountains and the stairways they serve for your finest hour. Praise the final hour and the reel of light that will play before you. Praise the reel and the hook. The day of man teaches you how to fish. Praise the fish and the seas they vanish into like the nameless. Praise the no names. Last ones to grab their diplomas. Underdogs of forgotten faces and embedded deeds. Their futures, clueless as the boy who don't know what he's praying to. The praise that you're praying for. The prey and the predator. The angel who shunned the first man. Praise the test that brought for mankind. Praise the men who were kind enough to have been the jackals. Praise the jackal and all the death he saw. He wanted to be Horus, to be godlike. Griffin of God, be man, woman, and child. Praise the girl, 12 years beautiful, who reads more than enough for her and her family. Praise family, how home develops in their hugs, strong arms and tackling fingers. Praise Super Bowl Sunday, and how it brings a family together. How funerals will bring about the family you never knew. Praise the phone calls, the grandmothers waiting on the other side who ask about all the faith stuffed in your pockets, the purpose plastered to your chest. Praise the passing Cadillac, blind side of your old soul in the rear view who runs over the toddler in the passing stroller that screams for your inner child to burst out. Praise the only child and the imagination who changed the world with. The ladybug who was his best friend, the caterpillar that made him believe in growth and metamorphosis. Praise the insects and how they view the universe so much larger than we do. The focal points for a bigger picture, paint songs all over town in American dreams, throw them in the wash and watch the cycles that birth an acid trip of American dream. Praise the dreams and realities that clash, the way humility of raindrops clash into your skin. Praise the skin you're in and every other book that made your body walk like a novel, spread your stories onto the surface after 19 years of living. Praise the 19 things you know now, the 19 things you'll learn tomorrow, the eager pupils of the pupil. Praise the teacher who will fulfill their duty, that will mold you into a brighter ember than they are. Praise the fire and the torch of your burning passions, all that love you bleed. Praise the lovers and the examples they lead, how the equator caresses earth at the waist. Praise the smile that you put on her face, the broken hearts in your hand, and the one that's gonna beat you back to life. Praise the song that's for every occasion, or the crate digging in the basement, or the stone and how they struck their last chord, the stone throwers and the revolutions they can't afford. Praise the future that will feel like forever, all the lives and the lost and found, ciphered around it. Ticking clock that talks all equilibrium from forests, mountains, vanishing seas. Give you all the reason to believe. Bow at the knees to shoot that prayer past that favorite colored sunset or the evening. It's all gone. So I have one more piece before I conclude. Can anybody hear me like this?
No?
Alright, I'll be loud as I possibly can, because this poem is very much a performance piece. So I really like to like get from the podium and perform it. This poem in particular, the background of it is as heavy as the poem itself. It's my latest piece. It's called 2020. And the whole poem is based on a vision that I had. I was just daydreaming one day, and like I usually do. And all these images came to my head, where the notion of, I look at the world now, and I read, I'm kind of a history buff, so I've been reading a lot of Howard Zinn, and you know, just our history as Americans, and just the history of the world. Things tend to repeat itself, right? And just certain things, actions that were committed, fluctuate like all these other like horrible things, like greed. So greed, I had the vision that in the year 2020, or the year 2019, right before 2020, that greed becomes so intense throughout the country, as far as those who are in authority and control things, that, which is majority ruled by men, that the world is crumbling, right? Which it kind of already is. I mean, well, it's fine. It's just cleansing itself. But you know, things are just crumbling. Things are crumbling. Things are crumbling. Society, things are crumbling. A lot of things are just going away. So, at this point in our history, it is up for women to save us, basically, because you know the way Earth is, the way Mother Nature is. You know, it resonates in the energy of women. You know, as they are nurturers, as they are caretakers. So basically, it's their job to save the world. They're the surrogates now, and it's a bunch of other things that come with the poem. So here it is. Grandma's talking about how they used to run numbers. Her mama grew up in the roaring 20s, bottle breaking, bootlegging, my heartbeat jams to ragtime of generations, never so lost from now. The blues always been a river that knows no clockworks, and these days, the earth can oil spill a scat. Now Nana plays lotto like they used to run numbers. She'll hit it big the day I fix the hunch in my back. My posture's become a cracked pinky square with the will to stand like midnight. Men today hunch at the twinkle of slot machines. Truncate foundations, women eating into our egos. And the news is as convoluted as our spines. As the year 2019 closes, greed impairs vision. Gambling men in global affairs have lost heart and integrity. War rages and the fifth element is love. Lost. Ends look odd when you roulette with hearts stacked as chips. Womenly surrogate platoons fight with heaven at their feet. And grandma kept the gun for these times. You see the reload of suffrage in her voice box. She knows crushing blow of an era. It's prohibition of what's pure. It's still littering to throw money on the floor. And the kings don't see it when casinos of desire shine brighter than solar. Luna's luminance hums Nana's gospels. But it won't calm these wolves who are drunk off the wrong moonshine. It tastes like oil wine and we won't wind down. Mothers breed sons who break bread with no wheat to grow. Martial law multiply monsters of men, make the matriarchy malicious, and Mother Earth rumbles all this like a lotto drawing. Now place your wages, stuff the money in your mouths, throw your hearts on the table. I mean, all is fair and the war for love. Hold tight to your tickets, but this is the ticket, always was, one of bravery, made us grant things their values. We used to run the numbers. Now we run from a countdown 10. Volcanoes and women scorn hurt the same 9. Gun smoke of freedom smells like perfume, feels like her womb 8. A mosque was burned. I got married the same day 7. Bullets, typhoons, and queens clash everywhere 6. Ball is dropping. Feels like the world is ending 5. I kiss my wife like the world is ending 4. My grandmothers are on the front lines fighting still 3. There's as much blood as the days we are born 2. Mama says solution is origin, then it is love, my son. Love, love, you better love like it's the only option. 1. Win or spun herself into a greenhouse. You can see everything now. Your vision is as perfect as the year. It's 2020. A lady still sings the blues. Surrogates have saved their men. Our third eyes are working, and I know because I can finally stand like midnight. It's all clear when dawn has us gaze at auroras in the sun. Grandma, war's over. You can put the gun away now. For the first time in her life, she cried and smiled in the same breath. Nana. Shoeing today, eh? 2020's gotta be a lucky number. She replies, no, baby. No more lotto. Love won the war. And that's all
ever once.